on the line. It's risky. People love to tear that down.
Well, Darren Jesse, Ben Folds, Robert Sledge, aka Ben Folds 5, thank you so much for doing this.
Yeah.
Really sure. Appreciate it. So we're surrounded by all this sort of Foldsian imagery here. Are we wondering if you could just give us an idea of exactly what's going on?
Well, they're photographs that I've made over the last 10 years. I like film, and when I'm on tour, it gives me something to do. And then I normally print them. All these have been printed in the dark room, but the ones that we have in here are much larger than I can print in the dark room. I usually print pretty small, and so they are printed the modern way. And yeah, that's what they are. They're all just little moments. I play piano, you know. I'm not a professional photographer as a day job, so I'm thrilled to, have my stuff up.
And is there anything about these particular works and the ones that have been selected that are communicating any particular thing, or is it just a wide spread of stuff?
I think it's just a wide range of stuff that I've shot. The stuff that was, available and printable, and I just sort of shot from the hip on what I chose. I just went through the images and thought, I like that one.
And do you use any specific equipment? Do you use sort of like Jeff Bridges roaming around with a little vintage camera?
He uses a monocule.
Yeah,
he has a little. He has a man that follows him around with this 19th century camera.
And of course, stenographer. I have a stenographer.
He says, shoot that, I'll be back later. Make it good. Don't waste my money.
Yeah. Don't embarrass me.
Yeah.
The one, on the side of that wall, there's one of a self-portrait of Shatner, William Shatner, and Joe Jackson doing The Tonight Show, which is a Jay Leno show.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was shot on the camera that Bridges used, because I played a show with Jeff Bridges and he was showing me his camera, which is an old wide lux.
Wide lux, yeah.
Yeah, and he did a self-portrait of the two of us, and I just copied what he does. And so that's a Bridgian.
Fantastic.
Okay, so coming back to the music, Ben, we know you started playing piano at a very early age and played drums and other instruments, and Robert and Darren, I think you started quite early in music too. Do any of you remember your first attempts to actually write songs and write music?
First one I wrote was a song called Brick.
Wow, that's a pretty good song.
Yeah, Darren said, I think we should write a song. I was like, how do you do that? He's like, I don't know, let's try it. So we did.
Good start.
Begin his work.
I was making up songs before I could play an instrument.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I played music to begin with. And I still do wake up with, not every day, but most days I wake up with a song in my head. Sometimes they're terrible. I don't know about these guys. I'm sure that they were writing songs from the time that they played instruments too.
Mm-hmm.
You were making up stuff when you were a kid.
Yeah, like a teenager, like 13, 14.
Right.
I started playing with people in the neighborhood and writing stuff, putting songs together.
Yeah. When I was a little kid, I took viola lessons. And this is kind of funny, I haven't thought about this in years, but I took viola lessons, or I was in the school orchestra. And I remember sitting around at home, and it just dawned on me that everybody's playing different parts in the orchestra, you know? And like when I listen to records, and I was, like 8 years old, and I listen to records, and I'm like, oh yeah, the guitar and the bass are doing different stuff. And so that kind of counterpoint thing dawned on me. This little tiny light went on in my little brain. And so I went home, and I swear to you, I had like a red crayon, and I was writing out lines, staff lines.
Right.
But it wasn't real. I mean, it was just me kind of like doing little dots on the page, And I was like, this is cool. I'm that word that starts with a P. I don't know what it is. Like, it's supposed to be precocious. But, nothing ever came of it, So that was my first thought about ever writing a song. I thought that would be cool to be Mozart, without really working at it very hard.
Yeah, and without the Pauper's Grave and all of that stuff.
He had the hair. He did have the Mozart.
Yeah, I wore that.
You had the wig?
Yeah, I wore the wig until I was 22.
Well, as I mentioned to you just before, we had Neil Sedaka on the podcast recently, and one of the things that he mentioned was that even after 50 years of sitting down to write songs, he still found it scary, and that mm-hmm. whole process is still daunting. I was wondering how you respond to that in terms of this being something of a reunion for you guys. Is it still a daunting process to actually start writing songs together?
I let Ben do have all the hard work, and I just kind of come in and, you know.
Jam.
I just jam, man. That's what I do.
I'm just kidding.
I don't know. I can't imagine anyone doesn't have some kind of completion anxiety about a song, you know. Because really, it's not all coming. Not in the hippy-dippy sense, but it's not all coming from you. It's just not. That's just not the way it works. So you don't know if your partner's going to let you down or not, you know. But you got your name on it. But I just never know if because you can, everyone, people like to express. That's what people do. That's what you're basically put on earth to do. And if you set it at a bar, then maybe you've done it, and that's it. Or if you could write an essay, or there's lots of different ways you could get it out. I mean, one of the cheapest, probably most lucrative ways is to do it through a song. Because the booze can be expensive, but you know, I mean, like, it is, and I think people who write topically maybe have an easier time. You know, if you say, I'm going to write a song about this, is going to be about line dancing, and then you do three verses about line dancing, and you sum it up in the chorus, and you go somewhere else in the bridge, all that stuff. You know what you're doing. But if you're writing more from how do I feel right now before you know what it means, I think that's hard. I don't know how Neil Sedaka does it, but he was one of my big influences when I was a kid.
Right.
I wanted to have a song published by the time I was 13 because I saw him play a concert, and he had told a story about his first song being published when he was 13.
Right.
It didn't happen.
Yeah.
And was there anything in particular about his songwriting that inspired you?
Well, it's just beautiful. I mean, the chords were so pretty, and I guess he sang in a kind of a female or a child's vocal range too. He's got this incredible extended tenor voice that's kind of freakish, and I think that and he still does too. And also, since I grew up listening to mostly R&B music. You know, it's black music is what they called it at the time. That's all I'd really heard. So when I heard some white guy making music, I was pretty pretty excited. Like, oh, I can do this too. And it was a different take on it. You know, it was just more careful in some ways. You know, maybe more guarded, but also like a lot of really pretty chords just for the sake of the chords. And I think Neil Sedaka is like an accomplished pianist too. I mean, it's like when I saw him play live, he played Chopin in the middle of the show.
Serious.
Yeah.
I was going to say, actually, I was wondering if Missing the War was maybe inspired by Sedaka, because it's the opening chords have a hint of solitaire about them.
Exactly. That's exactly where it came from.
Yeah.
And is there a typical way that songs start for you guys? I mean, obviously, you know, you think of something like Philosophy or One Angry Dwarf or something like that, and you get a sense that they are built around these strong piano hooks. And so we get a sense that that's where it starts, but is that actually the case?
Feels like lately a lot of the stuff starts with chord melody ideas. Melodies and chords.
Yes, yeah, it's almost always melody first. That's usually the first thing. Or if there's some kind of thing that I might be doing or we're doing that seems like maybe it's leading to a song, but most of the time it's about a melody. You know, and the chords, Philosophy, you mentioned, I wrote that on a bass guitar with no piano. I didn't have a piano in my house. And it was around the melody and the bass movement. Dun, 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 dun. And you know, and then I found the chords on the piano and gave it a riff at the top.
And when you typically take a song into the studio, how do you go about fleshing a song out? How's that group dynamic work when you go in with that initial idea?
I mean, it seems like the last few albums, what we've done is just have a bunch of ideas that we'll bounce around and play and work on, and then some of them will start to gain traction, others don't quite come together, and then just sort of start being selective and finding the ones we feel like we can actually complete and be satisfied with, which isn't always easy, but that's the process of making records. But yeah, lately it's been a lot of just trying to discover something new. Like, this sound feels like something we haven't done yet, and to go about it that way.
That's cool. And the harmonies as well has always been a really intricate part of what you do. Robert, when you are producing a harmony to come go along with something that Ben's doing, for example, is that more of a technical process? Do you guys get together at the piano and say, okay, perfect fourth, let's sing a seventh, or is it just something instinctive that you do?
Some of it is totally just built into it, you know. I might sing a third above Ben on a certain line, but other things are more composed in kind of a choral way, and Ben has a real solid idea about what he wants to do, you know. And some things might just be afterthoughts, like, well, maybe it seems like, you know, maybe we should have some singing in this song, you know, a little bit more background vocals, and just see how that works, you know. And it kind of comes about, and it kind of ends up being more important than we thought it was when we first started working on it. There's only really one song that I can think of that's like sort of a straight harmony. The rest are kind of more parts, kind of like a choral part. Like, there's a song called Hold That Thought on the new record where I just sing harmony with Ben on the verses, and that's pretty fun. Kind of
so obvious we'd never done it before. The background vocals allows us to be a three-piece and fill space. It's the unspoken instrument, really. Mm-hmm. And it would be very difficult without the strength of the background vocals, I think, to carry a show or anything. I think that would be tougher. I think it's the background vocals, or the vocals, you should call them, are really important.
Right. I think we're really getting good at some things, too, as we get older, you know.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah, I know. I know. I'm really glad we didn't age out at 30, like most everyone else in pop music. But, yeah, we can sing, like, unisons together really, really tight now, you know, kind of this undiscernible character between people.
Right.
You know, it's fun.
And what's your approach to coming up with suitable bass lines under Ben's piano parts? Is that kind of a complex negotiation that goes on there?
Well, when I used to play soccer, or you might call football here or something like that, the coach would always scream at us, like, to not bunch up around the ball. Mm-hmm. But I don't have a coach. I don't have to. I've grown up. I can, you know, eat as much jam and bread as I want. And no one's telling me not to sort of overplay the piano part. Right. So now I feel like I'm sort of glomming on to Ben's vocal and his piano. I think Joe Osborne, who was this kind of famous bass player, session bass player, mm-hmm. Put it really well. He just said that, you know, the music, you know, all bass lines are already sort of in the music, and everything kind of comes from the music. And so I feel that way. Like, I can pull a little rhythm from here, a little melody from there, and then, you know, maybe kind of also play rhythm, just straight rhythm like a bass player. But I kind of like to jump around between different roles, melody and rhythm.
It's
and
like a halfback.
Exactly.
He's playing midfield. Yeah.
And when you approach something like the new album, do you come to it with some kind of sense of the traits of a Ben Folds 5 record? Do you think, right, okay, we need a certain amount of energy here, we need to overdrive that bass, we need to arpeggiate some of that piano, or is it just much more organic than that?
Most of the time it's more organic than that, but you know, you use what you can. I think we use what we can when we're making a record. Sometimes, like, what have we tried? Someone will bring up, early in the session, Darren brought up, why don't we just try the obvious, kick in distortion, play the cymbals harder, and see if that doesn't make the section work, and it did. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. But that's not the way we normally think about it. I think normally we're trying to do things that we haven't heard before, and usually when we do those things, I walk out of the studio thinking, God, that's radically different. No one's going to recognize this band anymore. And then I hear it a couple of weeks, and it's like, oh, that's us, and that's who it is. Right. But yeah. I think it's good to try to break that.
Yep. I completely agree. A lot of the things that you think are characteristics of the band are just inherent in when we sit down and play.
Right.
Well, then we're really spending time crafting the songs, but a lot of the sound, like the sound it makes, mm-hmm. is sort of just inherent when we play.
Even when we switch instruments, that is when Robert's playing upright bass. And,
yeah, even,
and I switch
more
into
so
an upright,
in a way.
It sounds like yeah. us. Yeah. Right. Well, that's the way we had our first and most prominent hit was, he never really played upright bass very much, and he's got an upright bass. There's a piano sitting in the middle of the room that was just purchased like 2 days before, maybe, for $50, and we're all doing this thing in the room together. That ended up being the hit. And
that was Brick, yeah.
Brick, that's the way Brick was. And, you know, I didn't think it sounded like us at all at the time. Now it's defined us, and that's what more people probably know than most things.
And one of our favorite songs off the new album, Sky High, which Darren, I think he wrote that one. Was that pretty much complete when you took it into the studio, or did it evolve once you presented it to the band?
It did evolve quite a bit, but it was, as far as what you call the tune, it was complete. But as far as the arrangement, it definitely evolved quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. From my point of view, it's pretty much the same as the demo. I think his demo was fully realized. The thing is I just played the piano parts that were played on the guitar, and then translated them into piano the same way as you would if you were taking a text from German and turning it into English or something, you know.
Yeah.
But piano is such a distinctly different instrument.
I think that's a modest answer, but I'll accept it. But
that's
true. it became something else. But as far as just the tune part of it, yeah, because I'm different than Ben. I don't want to think about making a lyric decision in the studio. That's too much pressure for me. I'd rather just go in knowing I've made that decision, and it's just about recording.
Yeah. I think it's really interesting. Like, Sky High is an interesting song that brings together, like, production-wise, it brings together a lot of things that we'd done, you know, in the hiatus. I mean, Darren worked on his songwriting and, you know, writes really great songs, and he brings in this really great song. And Ben's been making records a certain way where it's not necessarily band-centric, you know. It might be a bit more of a production piece, you know, sort of adding things and taking away things so you feel like it's just right. And, you know, I don't know, maybe I brought in a capacity to play bass, upright bass more in tune or something, or singing.
Well, it's kind of the heart of the arrangement.
Yeah. But
the bass is that part.
Yeah, so that song is a bit more of a kind of a production piece.
Yeah.
And it's not all kind of played in one room all the time. Things are kind of, it's more kind of a classic studio kind of thing. You know.
Which was different for us, actually.
It's painting with sound.
but I'll be the guy who comes in on every record and says, all right, we have to have a song with upright piano and acoustic bass. I was saying that in the first week. So it's like, even though we probably will anyway, I think it's great to hear this band do that in the course of a record.
We got that kind of impression from it, from the lushness of the backing vocals as well on that one. You know, made us think of like 10cc or something like that. You know?
That's exactly what it was.
It was a nod to that, yeah.
Oh, right, good.
Really, the 10cc invented an instrument, and for all practical purposes, on that song. Mm-hmm. And then we just used that instrument. That's really what it was, right. Which is singing Oz diatonic in the key of the song.
Yeah.
And looping them, and then sending them all through the board, through the entire song, and you only bring up the notes that you want.
Right.
So that's I don't know what they would call that, the 10cc.
Like having a mellotron of your own band or something.
Yeah, it is. It's like having your own mellotron, but it's the most intense. It's just such an amazing sound. We barely used it. Really, it's not. It sounds like it's used a lot, but if you kind of look at where it's sitting in the mix, it's not that loud, but it's such a beautiful instrument.
Yeah. It's kind of amazing because of the limitations, you know. Using sampling, you can just press a key.
Yeah.
But if you're using faders, it's just kind of a different feel.
Yeah.
You know, your timing's different. You want to pull things out. And so the difference, you know, the difference between your timing and boom, and wait for it.
Yeah.
It's not that big a deal, but when you use a fader, it's like 20 times that, you know.
Kind of idiotic of me. I was thinking that we needed some sound that would make you feel like there were some clouds going by. But then I think about it, and it's all about blue sky, so he didn't actually put clouds in the lyrics, so maybe I got the wrong thing.
No, but I think that's what makes things good. The slight bit of conflict is always good, and like contradictions in songs are always good.
Yeah.
They always work.
That's true.
It's what makes drama.
Yeah.
And so what point do words actually become important then? Are you the sorts of songwriters who are always noting down interesting words and phrases and keeping a notebook full of ideas?
I have a couple of ideas on my phone, but I don't do much of that, really.
I let the music decide what the words are going to be. But I spend a lot of time and effort on the lyrics because I'm not good at it. I like to try to find the thing that's not going to fuck up my melody, you know. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's like Darren was saying about contradictions. The most obvious pinheaded version of that in for a melody as it sits with lyrics is a happy melody that has a sad lyric, or vice versa, you know. But you got to figure out what that is, you know. It strikes me as funny that the melodies not only have meanings, they have subtext. Like a melody might be, well, that's a sad melody. It sounds like about loss. But the subtext is, this guy's a rich asshole. You know, that might be the subtext in the melody. It's like you listen to it, it's like it sounds like a douchebag, or it sounds like a lot of someone's trying too hard to prove themselves, or they're physically just probably too driven that way, or something. You could hear something
about a love interest too.
Yeah, I usually write and love it, and then I test them for test audiences, focus groups, and we kind of see, we change the ending sometimes.
And there's a lot of striking imagery and quite idiosyncratic phrases in your songs. I'm thinking of songs like Stephen's Last Night in Town, Battle of Who Could Care Less, that seem to touch upon how you interact as friends. They seem to be born out of sort of shared experiences. Would that be correct assumption?
Shared experiences with who?
Sort of like something like Stephen's Last Night in Town feels like something you guys would have heard about or talked about and or experienced together at some point. And are these just all fictional scenarios?
Sometimes they are, and sometimes they're not. That one was about a guy, he was English, and this was in Nashville, Tennessee. He was an engineer who worked for Paul McCartney. And he came in and charmed everyone for about 3 weeks, and everyone thought he could do no wrong, you know, cool accent and stuff. But then he started realizing he didn't know the guy. It was a little weird, you know. And I made this on a 4-track tape, and I gave it to the guy himself, because he kept on saying, let's throw another party. And he kept on throwing good night or goodbye parties to him, and he kept coming back. Maybe 2 or 3 times he missed his plane or something like that.
Yeah.
There's another party reference in one of my songs that's in the solo era, which is just comes from... From my point of view, it's fiction. I make sure, kind of tongue-in-cheekedly, I say that it's true over and over again when I play shows. But it says it's about Robert Sledge's party. Well, it wasn't Robert's party, and it wasn't actually Darren's, but it came from a story that Darren had told me one time, and I just took it to heart and put it in the song.
Mm-hmm. Not the same, that was.
Not the same. Yeah.
I would say this about Battle of Who Could Care Less is that, you know, I think, if I can say this, it comes out of this frustration in Chapel Hill, you know, this sort of competition to be cooler, you know, and to be a little bit more indifferent, mm-hmm. you know. And I definitely think that was a shared frustration between the band. Because, I don't know, for me, like I'm like trying to strive to play really well mm-hmm. and kind of expand myself. But that's just not cool at all to be a better musician. Like, you're good enough already, man. What's your deal?
Yeah.
Why are you trying so hard?
Well, one of the things we've heard you say, actually, I think, is that in this band, it's great that everyone is able to actually handle the sorts of things that are thrown at them.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's an interesting...
More or less. Yeah. Sometimes. I had a tricky moment one time when Ben wanted me to sing this background vocal for Kate, and I was just sitting there going, I just can't sing and play that. But then I did. So, whatever. I would shed it.
And you know, you mentioned this idea of test audiences and pilots and that sort of that kind of a metaphor. Do you actually write around characters? Because we notice there's always names in the songs, isn't there? You've got Kate, you've got Stephen's Last Night in Town, solo stuff, Zach and Sarah, Michael Prater on the new album. Do you actually sort of construct these characters in your mind when you write?
That probably would be my contribution. I just always put people's names in. I don't know why. I've said I know why before, but I don't really know why. I just, that's what comes and seems interesting to me. And also, I like songs that I feel good about writing songs and that don't sound like songs when you take the music away. You know, I would rather write to a physics book than the typical imagery that you have in a song, a t- the typical, yeah, baby, we got it going on, can't do this, whatever.
Trying to make rain and pain rhyme.
Rain and pain, it's horrible. Who does that? But I mean, sometimes you lean on those, the lexicon of music, pop music lyrics. It's like it was like we dumbed our vocabulary down to just like two or three images in pop world when it could be so much more, and it can be a short story about someone's life, which I've always found really useful because it takes heat off of me.
So I mentioned Michael Prater, which is one of our favorite songs on the album. Mm-hmm. We just wonder what the story was behind that song.
It's not really a story so much as the music, again, like it always does, came first, and it made me think about the kind of person that you always run into your whole life that just seems so random. I think "so random" is in the lyrics. Mm-hmm. Just random. Like they're your partner in Boy Scouts or something. It's like, why this guy? All right, fine. And then later on, you know, like in this case, it's a composite of different characters I've known like that. That it's not that I wanted to shake them off. It's just I didn't understand why they kept on coming back and back and back. Mm-hmm. And the last thing about the parking lot was true. I was going through a divorce. I was driving back home with my tail tucked between my legs to my parents' house at probably 5 or 6 in the morning. And there's this guy sleeping in his car in the parking lot. And that was someone I'd known from kindergarten I kept running into. He's the weatherman back home. And he's also, he was married and then he was divorced, but he's gay. And I guess he didn't know he was gay, and he was sleeping in the car. So, you know, one thing led to another. We hung out in his car. You know, I don't want to talk about it. You can cut that. That's not true. Yeah, but that's stories. They just put them together.
You do seem to pick up on these kinds of comedic, humorous situations though, and work them into songs. Have you, I mean, obviously we're fans of things like Has Been with William Shatner and, you know, other stuff. I mean, you've worked with people like Weird Al Yankovic as well. Do you pick up things from those people about the relationship between humor and songwriting?
I think all three of us have as much of a comedian's mindset as we do a musician's. And that's why I think there's so many comedians who gravitate towards our music. It's not to say that we think everything's funny. It's actually the other way around. It's actually, I think it's a way. People who are funny are just, it's just part of life. You're dealing with something, and humor is the way that you're doing it. You know, I mean, I'd argue that really the only rock and roll going on in the States right now probably is comedians.
Yeah.
Actually, I think I heard you mention that Andy Kaufman was an influence on your
Dude.
Lyrics.
Yeah.
In what sense was...
He was an influence. He was an inspiration, probably more than an influence. But it was an inspiration because when I was a kid, I'm watching this on television, and I think it instilled in me the idea of surprise. It doesn't have to be a practical joke. That practical joke is for frat boys. It's a surprise. It's like, that's an amazing gift to give someone. Like, he'd be on TV, and you know this guy is there to do something naughty, and he still would surprise you, even with everyone expecting it was coming. It was kind of like the reason that... Sacha Baron Cohen would have moved to the United States for a while to do his Ali G's because he's worn it out over here. It's like to continue to surprise people is really difficult. And in music, you can do that in lots of different ways. You can write about things that are slightly awkward, slightly surprising. You can take two bars out of a pre-chorus before the chorus so the chorus hits sooner than you think. All those things to me somehow, I believe, have some kind of root in getting such a massive kick out of people like Andy Kaufman when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And Darren, when you work on something like Hotel Lights, for example, mm-hmm. have you developed any other sort of alternate approaches to produce some material that works in a different way to when you're, you know, subject to the tyranny of Ben, for example?
Don't answer that.
Well, yeah, that whole project, in a sense, is completely different than this band,
right?
So like every detail of it is a completely different role for me. I'm trying to think of specifically some example, but I mean, I play piano and guitar and I sing and I hire musicians, and you know, I'm playing drums here and singing a little bit, so it's very different in that
yeah.
sense.
we'll have to wrap up in a minute, but we just got a couple more questions I wanted to ask about On Being Frank. Do you want to?
Sure, yeah, we noticed it's kind of got a more of a kind of classic singer-songwritery kind of feel to it, almost like a Jimmy Webb type song, we thought.
Yep, completely.
What's the story behind that one?
I had thought that it would be an interesting way to show how people at an end of a relationship, if it's a long-term relationship, what happens to their ego. Mm-hmm. That's mainly where it comes from. So in this case, it's what if Frank Sinatra's tour manager, he's been working for him for 30 years, and then Frank dies, and then he's defined himself in a role that no longer exists. So where does he go with that? And I just imagined that character. That's one that I had the concept, and I'd actually kind of written it almost like it was a short story. I had that concept before the music, and I found the music for that one. And and I just thought, this guy's probably into some Jimmy Webb in that era. It's kind of macho, but pretty, kind of what's happening next. It just felt right to me, more than it would to say, like, put it in the style of My Way or something. It seemed right to me.
I would say also that, like, we made an attempt to actually to channel that era and kind of play like the Cats, who might be session cats in that era, which I think was what most people expected us to play like a long time ago. We used to have these kind of, you know, older guys come and be like, what is wrong with y'all? Like, y'all don't play nearly as good as the people that
used happened to us literally, actually, with some old guys that made great records. They told us that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and like, and of course, we were like, don't you understand? Like, that's not sort of the point. Like, we're not, like, we don't play. Like, we're being different than you, you know? But, like, so I kind of was, after years and years of kind of like sitting around doing session work with people and stuff, like, I felt like I had the confidence to try to play like Joe Osborne or Lee Sklar or somebody like that. But I gave myself maybe a C+ on that effort. But I think it's an A+ at being in this band, you know, or making a song work.
You got a couple of A moments.
Yeah.
We have some great moments.
Some great, great.
And the new album, The Sound of the Life of the Mind, was, I think, recorded in Ben's studio in Nashville.
Most of it was.
Right. Yeah. And is that an environment where you're all playing live in one room?
Yeah. It's a gorgeous room.
Is technology an important part of that process, or is it just more about the energy and the vibe?
It was, because we played a lot, and we did some editing on Pro Tools, which we didn't do on our first two records.
No. Put Beat Detective on the drums.
No, we didn't.
No, we absolutely
he
did
could
not.
Never figure that out. That Beat Detective is not smart enough.
Just so tight.
Well, I think we can get away with using Pro Tools edits and things because there's just this feel that we naturally have. So we use it more in like our producer used it in very, I would say, okay ways, good ways. We're not moving little things around like spending all day lining up things. Our downbeats sound like smudges, and that's okay.
And was being in Nashville kind of an influence on that rollicking kind of country feel on Do It Anyway? Because that's kind of different to a lot of what you've done before.
I think we could have played that song if we, you know, just like Steely Dan sounds like they're from New York when they live in California. Mm-hmm. You know, we're definitely from the South, and you know, country, we could break into a country song at any time. Very believable. We could, you know, be in Saipan and do that. Mm-hmm. But definitely, I mean, it's a little oppressive in some ways. Like, God, would you quit it with the country stuff, Nashville? You know.
Yeah.
But then it's kind of fun to. I personally kind of fall in and out of love with the country music industry.
Mm-hmm. We loved your Fraggle video, by the way.
Oh, good.
Yeah, we're big fans of the Fraggles growing up in the 80s.
Yeah, nostalgic rush.
It was great. So if you do another album, and we hope that you do, will you go the Pledge Music route again? Because we know you used that service in part of the crowdfunding process of the record, didn't you?
I don't think we know what we would do yet.
Yeah. The industry is evolving so quickly. That, who knows? I will say it was a really great experience, and they get it, and I would highly recommend someone go through them. I thought it was they were honorable. It's a good experience.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Okay. Well, I think that's all from us. So, thank you so much
for
doing this.
We
really appreciate it.
Yeah, best of luck with the rest of the tour as well.
Thanks. Cool.
Michelle.
Thanks.
Cheers, guys.
Thanks, guys.
All right. All right.